time once again for Unstoppable Mindset, where inclusion, diversity, and the unexpected meet. What a great way to start a podcast. I'd like to thank you all for listening. I'm Michael Hinkson, your host. Today, our guest is Iris Yoning Yi, who started out life in China and then came to the United States, went to Berkeley, which we can't complain about since I live in California. But now she's at the University of Michigan, so we can have a great discussion about football teams, I suppose, but we'll see. But Iris, I want to welcome you to Unstoppable Mindset. Thank you for taking the time to be here with us.
Thank you so much. Well, Ohio State will be super happy if you discuss football with us, right?
Well, that's fine. Let them suffer. That's okay. My wife was did her master's work at USC. So, we have all sorts of different and diverging challenges with football, don't we?
Right. Yeah. We had all of the just enemies all coming together.
Yeah. Makes life fun. Well, yeah, USC's been doing pretty well this year so far, and Michigan's been doing pretty well.
We now all know that you're following up on the news. Happy to hear that.
Yeah. Well, that is great. Well, tell us a little bit about you growing up and all of that and how you ended up over in the U.S. and such. Love to hear about your growing up in China and all that.
Sure. Well, I spent 20 years of my life in China. So basically all of my education previously, I'm from the northern part of China, which is a city next to Beijing. It's called Tianjin. So I grew up there and I did all of my education there from kindergarten all the way to college. And then in junior year, I got the chance to come to UC Berkeley to study abroad. So I came to UC Berkeley during my junior year. And then after 1 year in Berkeley, I was fortunate. I found a internship, which I wanted to figure out if I still want to stay in my finance major, which is what I did when I was at college. So I stayed one more year after that study abroad year for a year of internship in Bay Area. And then I went back to my home country. I worked there for 2 years. And then now here I am. I'm currently a graduate student at UMich. So this is the whole journey of me in a nutshell.
And what was your major on your undergraduate major?
In undergrad, I did pure business, pure finance. Now I'm currently in information science, so user research and software related.
Ah, that's quite a change, it seems to me, going from one to the other.
That was, and it involved a whole story of how the changes came. The finance major was popular, you know, back in 2017. And everybody thinks, oh, if you go to finance, if you go business, you will make a lot of money, you will have a well-off life. So that was why I chose it. And then from sophomore year, I tried to figure out, is that the right thing for me? It turned out to be not really. I'm not too happy doing the financial analysis work I did. So I get involved in the startup system in Berkeley, utilize that. And then I pivoted to the product software field. And that was where I felt more comfortable than previously. So that was the journey. And also in a really short format.
Sure. Sure. You have a really good command of English. Did you learn that in China? Do they emphasize that at all? Or how does that work?
Well, yeah, I would say I'm personally pretty lucky that I grew up in a city and grew up in a system that is not too demanding of the study, the amount of homework you have to do. It was still pretty demanding, but it was a great combination of you explore your interest versus what you have to do to complete in school. So the English classes I took all of the local education system. So I did not go to international school. I did not go to any international such as boot camp. The local classes of English is basically teacher teaching you what is from textbook. But I tried to learn by myself. more outside of class. So I try to listen to some materials, ABC News, CNN News. That helped me a lot in getting a foundation of speaking or just communication English and mindset in English. I think this is partially helpful for me. The other part has been beneficial for me is definitely coming to US and to talk to people here, and to pick up the jargons or pick up the colloquial expressions.
Right. Well, clearly, overall, you value education very highly. How would you describe your opinion of education and why do you value it so highly?
Well, I'm really thankful that you asked this question. I think education, as I already introduced my experience a little bit, that means opportunity to me. Because of the education and because of the choices I had from a local education system in where I grew up in China, all the way to Berkeley, and I came back and then come back. So the back and forth is opening a lot of doors for me to explore, such as, is finance a great thing for me? Is product a great thing for me? And how can I navigate through each of the education stage? And also, I started as a student, and I got the chance to kind of do a graduate student instructor position right now in my school. So from the two aspects coming, it's both is a lifelong learning experience because it's unstoppable. That was what we are discussing right now. And on the other hand, as an instructor, I feel opportunity is unstoppable for those who are benefiting from the education that we can give to them.
So unstoppable is definitely a term that you would use to describe education and the need for education.
Well, I totally feel that. And especially when I saw your podcast, the theme, unstoppable, I was like, this is the keyword for education, that for opportunity for students and instructors.
Yeah. Well, I think that the person who stops learning is just not going to go anywhere. We should always try to learn and continue to learn and explore new things and be adventurous. Life's an adventure, and all too often we don't ever view it that way, and we should.
It is. And education, I personally will think about it really broadly. It's not only about what I learned from class, but what I learned from my graduate school. It's from all aspects of life, such as I'm learning by listening to your podcast or by talking with you and learning how you can figure out, such as text reading screen. And I learned by talking to my parents of some life tricks, how you can do your luggage in a faster way. All of those are learnings to me.
Well, it is an adventure. How do I want to ask this? How would you view education in China as opposed to, and the beliefs about education in China as opposed to what we see in the United States? Is that something that's easy to compare or talk about?
Yeah, I think I can probably talk about it for the whole day, but just pick several points currently on the top of my mind. Because I took the first 20 years, almost 20 years of my education in China, I felt I had a wonderful foundation of science and also logical thinking, both from school and both from my family. What we heard from the media and what we heard from the publication that the education system in Asia is quite demanding, that has a lot of assignments, homework you have to finish. But on the other side, when I'm looking back to the education of that methodology, it helped me to building up the repetitive methods and practice a lot. So I still have clear and crystal clear memory of, such as, what is how to calculate the area of a square of all of those math foundation, I can still do it really well. So I think this is really helpful for me in the long term of my career or for my science field. And for the American education, I definitely cannot summarize it in one or two sentences, but it encouraged more in asking questions. This is the first observation I had when I came. Asking questions is everywhere in the class. When you're sitting there, the teacher will, instructor will encourage you to ask questions. They will always check back with the students. Do you have any questions? And what are your thoughts right now? So the encouragement of asking questions is also stimulating a sense of discussion in class, which is also unique in the American education system, which I definitely did not try any other countries, but just comparing these two, I think this is unique.
Interesting. Do you think that the educational system in general is more demanding in China than in the US in terms of learning and the work that needs to be done or that is done?
It is demanding in different ways. The American education system is also really demanding. I think the China education system is demanding in the repetitiveness. You have to work on assignments and it's pretty long hours for kids. After you get back from school, such as 5 p.m., you get from school back from school, you have 3 to 4 hours of assignments. You probably need to spend that time on it because it's due tomorrow. So that is the demanding aspect of the China education system versus the U.S. education system is also really demanding. I did have a depression period when I was in junior, when I was in UC Berkeley, because I was not able to deal well of my classes and the credits. It was demanding because it was hard. It was progressing fast. And it was more independent. You have to figure out all of the questions by yourself, even though the instructor is there, the office hour is there. You need to find your own way to study and to make it through. So that was also super demanding.
So it's more structured in a sense in China. But here, what I'm hearing you say is that the demand was that you had to figure out more things rather than it being in a structured way given to you.
I agree. This is a great summary and a great summary of the differences.
Yeah.
And if we take a step back, what I observe in Asia or in China in general is there's always a expectation on you. After you graduate from college, you have to have a white collar job. This is the expectation that is already a default setting. Versus in the US is more freestyle. If you go to some career tracks that is not perceived as white collar or just high end, it's okay. Nobody will judge you. So I think if we take a step back, it's true that for the different system and in societal expectations.
Yeah, and I'm not at all saying one is better or worse than the other. They're different.
Yeah, same. They're just different in the culture and in a society.
And that's okay. Ultimately, the final thing that we need to do is to learn, and hopefully people do that.
Yeah, and what I tried to do and what I realized during my college was that instead of being a student, I can probably be a teacher to some extent. So that was a moment, a silver lining shining on me that I realized instead of being in the education system on the side of students, I can also be on the side of teacher. So in junior year, I decided to volunteer in the local community to be an instructor of a inmates reentry boot camp. That was also a different aspect that I was able to learn from my experience.
Tell me more about that. That's fascinating. An inmates boot camp or introductory boot camp. Tell me more about that, if you would.
For sure. So in my junior year, when I was at Berkeley, I heard there was an organization that was called Prisoners Literature Project, where they, in that project, the volunteers try to gather the books and send back to the inmates in the prison based on what they're requesting. So such as some inmates will write letters to us, say, I would love to read some fiction books. I would love to read novels. And we will pick the book from our database and from our donation and mail it back to them. So that was how I started to get involved in this community. I also saw several prisoners after they get out of prison, they came back to our PLP, Prisoners Literature Project, to help us to do the volunteer. So at that moment, I was thinking, okay, what are other ways can I get involved in this? And I, at that moment, I only knew data analysis. So I started a data analysis class for them. And there were about 11 MAs coming in and learn it. It was super rewarding at the end, because at the beginning, I did not realize the minimum wage issue in the whole inmate system. But because of the lack of skill sets and because of the societal pressure on re-entry inmates, in 2020, I remember the data, about 60% of them don't even have a job, where the unemployment rate of U.S. was about 15%. So that was a huge contrast. And because of the program we started for the re-entry and for the data analysis education, 8 out of them were able to get the job in a really decent environment and a really decent job setting. So that was when I started in the instructor role on the other side of education. That was the very beginning of my journey.
Why is the unemployment rate so high, and what do we do to bring it down?
That's such a great question. I hope that I can be a president sometime to solve that problem. long story short, just several things I personally observed is, first of all, the school says after the prisoners and inmates have been in prison for some of them 15 years, some of them 5 years, the world is changing too fast for people to catch up. Even though I'm not in the prison, I'm currently in outside, I'm able to access the information, I still feel lagging behind, left behind thousands of times a day. People talking about, have you used ChatGPT? People talk about, have you used any other AI tool before? It's just changing too fast for people to catch up. So the skill sets are in demand right now are not caught up by the inmates. So this is the first reason. And the second reason is still the some stigma and a stereotype on inmates, who the employers might think they're not safe to employ or feel they're not reliable to employ. So they're filtered out from a lot of opportunities. And lastly is, as soon as they're out of the prison, or as soon as they're out of and facing with re-entry, it's so overwhelming. Just imagine that you are out, you need to deal with your utilities, you need to deal with your family, you need to deal with your housing. Everything comes together. Job seeking is not even the priority at the moment, and they need the help to rebuild their life. So these are the three reasons I personally can see from the data.
And there aren't really acculturalization classes in the prisons to help integrate people back into society, or they're just, it's too much to learn that they just don't have time to do it all.
What I see in the California, when I was volunteering in the Five Ventures and volunteering in the PLP, first of all, is prison in the sense of preserving their safety and security. They're still trying to cut down a lot of connections of prisoners through with the outside world, such as they are only, when I was mailing back the books, There were certain books not allowed, so certain genres not allowed by certain prisons. Depends on the region and depends on the city the prison or facility is in. And also, they are not allowed to have such as pens in some prisons because it's considered as a
sharp weapon. Instrument.
Yeah, sharp instrument, a weapon, potential weapon. That was only a small fraction of all of the restrictions from their life there. So we can only imagine how many other restrictions they have that is limiting the connections with the world. And also, just as the Defy Ventures I volunteer for, or the PLP, there were nonprofits working on that. It's not scalable. Just imagining that we only have 6 volunteers there, and we can just cover as much as 30 re-entry people. Imagine how many people are coming out every single day. The scalability requires more a second thought, or just a reimagining of the current system.
How can you teach those of us on the outside about all of this and help us become more sensitized to trying to help?
This is what I've been thinking a lot about these days. So several things I can do right now. So first of all, is there was another nonprofit I got involved with these days or in the last year. It was called Impartial. So Impartial, what we did was we collected the art work from the previous prisoners or inmates, and we sell it to others. So we try to utilize this way to help them to make money. And a lot of the inmates, post-release inmates, they like drawing, they like writing, they have a lot of creativity that is not known by others. So utilize this and also transform their labor or transform their creativity into something profitable is a great way, as far as I see, a great way to give them back for their labor, for their devotion into the society and also into this world. And the other way I think can be helpful is just voice out as for me, I have been an instructor there. I have been an activist there. I can talk with you, and the more audience listening to this podcast will know this issue. And whenever they see people from the background, they're willing to help or willing to get involved in more instructions and a more education program. That would be wonderful.
We get so locked into prejudices and so locked into specific ideas that we really don't take it further. I've said for a long time, for example, about people with disabilities that we're not brought into or involved in the conversation, but I can see where what you're talking about with people in the prisons and so on is very much the same way. We don't really involve them, or we don't really choose to have conversations about all that, which limits our knowledge all the more.
Yeah, I'm also curious about in your community. So what kind of limitations did you see in the disabled community or able in different ways community that the limitations of how you can voice out and the conversations that you were not able to participate in?
Well, first of all, I would reject the concept of able in different ways. Ability is ability. We may use different tools or different techniques to accomplish the task, but our abilities are the same. Our knowledge is the same. So it's when people talk about different abilities or differently abled, I think that's such a misnomer and an inappropriate thing, because it isn't true. As I said, it's different techniques, perhaps, and different tools than you use. And for you, your disability has been covered up pretty well. And that is to say, you're light dependent, which I love to talk to people about. Every person on this planet has a disability, and the disability for most people is that they're light dependent. You don't do well if suddenly the power goes out and you're left in the dark. But with Thomas Edison inventing the electric light bulb and we spending so much time to make sure that people have access to light pretty much all the time, your disability is covered up. But make no mistake, the disability is still there. Does that make you differently able than I am, who is light independent? I think the answer is no. It's just that you have different techniques that you use to have access to information like monitors and light that allows you to see what's going on, where I get the information in other ways. But we don't tend to have conversations about a lot of these things, and the prisons and prisoners are in the same situation because we fear. And we get very uncomfortable about things that are different and people who are different than we are. And sometimes we build up images that aren't true. And sometimes we just create these fears that we can't deal with them because they're not the same as us and we are better than they are.
Well, this is the new education I just had today, right? That the concept of disabled versus able in with different abilities. These are the two ways I heard about people describing this community before. But now it makes totally sense about how we are disabled in different ways. Last week, when I was walking in dark, I was not able to get my key in my door, the lock. I was there for 5 minutes, cannot touch it, cannot feel it. How can I survive it like this?
Exactly. And the reality is that it's a matter of learning the techniques, and it's a matter of learning how to do it. So you could learn how to find the appropriate place to put your key in the lock. And you could learn to do that by touch, but it's a process. And since that's not normally the way you do it, it becomes a little bit different situation for you.
Do you feel that we are just educated? Or we require different learnings in our life? So such as the prisoners, they might require a type of learning of reentry, which is currently what I don't need to, or what you don't need to, such as you need to learn about how to navigate through a dark environment from way earlier than I do. So we are just navigating through different learnings and education at variety moments of our lives.
I think our learning is something that comes based on our experiences and our environments. So as a blind person, I don't tend to learn how to do things using light as the main vehicle to give me access to information. I do it in other ways. Now, at the same time, I think it's important that I understand what eyesight is to you and why it's important. And I have no problem with that. Where I think the breakdown comes is when most people have eyesight and they believe that unless you can see, you're less than we are. That's where I think the problem comes, because most people think that eyesight is the only game in town. And if you don't have eyesight, you can't possibly be as good as we are. And likewise, if you're a person who has been a prisoner, then clearly there's something wrong with you. Otherwise, you'd never have been a prisoner. And it doesn't make sense to it necessarily have to be that way.
It connects back to the questions we talked about earlier, that how can we encourage more people to get involved in this initiative, such as reentry for inmates, helping them to learn the life skills coming back to society. Everybody has a blind spot in their life, such as my blind spot is probably if I don't talk with you before, I have never got a chance to talk with you. I will never learn that what is the different disabilities and the learnings versus people with eyesight versus not. that was, I don't have the empathy for that. And it's the same idea for an education and a prisoner's scenario, because people don't try to understand what is the life scenario of the inmates who are currently in the reentry process. So they don't have the empathy and they don't have the ability to comprehend their situation.
Well, you're right. I would say, though, that the difference is, say, between you and any number of other people is you're open to learning and gaining that empathy. And although you may start out with a particular belief, you are right. Willing to explore alternatives, whereas there are so many people who aren't. And that's where the challenge comes. I have been in situations where a child has come up to me and wanted to talk to me, and the parents have just grabbed the child and said, no, don't talk to that man. He might not like it, or, they come up with all sorts of excuses. Or I'm walking with my guide dog. I remember one time I was in a hotel and I was walking from the desk. I had to turn down a long corridor and then go up a little ways and then make another left turn to get to my room. And there were people who were behind me and they kept saying, how does that dog know where he wants to go? Because the presumption is I can't possibly know it since I can't see it. The reality is the last thing I want is the dog to know. I have to give the dog commands. The dog's job is to make sure that we walk safely. And, they said, well, how does the dog know when to turn? And here I am giving hand signals and saying left, left, left. And they don't even acknowledge that, or they ignore it because that doesn't fit their image of what a blind person is. So the answer is it's all about more education. It's more discussions, which is why I chose 22 years ago after September 11th to travel around and speak and talk about blindness and talk about lessons we should learn about September 11th and other such things, so that people will learn that we are all on the same planet and we need to all learn to be a little bit more accepting of those who are different than we are.
Right. And education, the key, one of the keys for education I see is curiosity, as we talked about. Curiosity comes in when there's some contradictory information coming in. How can you piece together? And when there's something against what you're believing in, can you be open-minded? The curiosity is taking people a long way of learning. Learning is not only about what we are taught right now in class, but also such as I learned that from you, that you give your guide dog a hand sign of turning left or turning right.
Well, and verbal commands as well.
Right. Yeah. So all of the commands coming together.
But the issue is that a lot of people don't notice that. They just think it's amazing what this dog does to lead this blind man around. Dogs don't lead, they guide, because it's not the dog's job. The dog's job is to make sure that we walk safe. It's my job to give direction. And there are so many different kinds of situations like that, where we just lock ourselves into one point of view and don't argue with the facts, or don't confuse me with the facts. It's not what I'm used to, and so I'm not going to accept that. And it's so unfortunate when that happens, because there's so many people who operate in so many different ways that we just tend not to want to pay attention to that. And that's where getting back into the conversation. So things like this podcast, hopefully people learn something from it, and so many different things that you do and so on. I think we're all teachers. And I know you said earlier you never thought of yourself being really a teacher, but clearly you are. And you're very much involved in the education field in so many ways. The fact is, I think all of us can and ought to in some ways view ourselves as teachers. And that's a good thing.
I can relate a lot to your September 11th. So after that, you decided to the realization that we are on the same planet, and that we need to learn from each other more. I think that was the same point for me, the moment of my life, that because of Prisoner's literature project and because of the first ever instructional experience I had, I decided to get involved more of the education field because I see the opportunity and I see the unstoppable side from the students learning and also from the teachers aspect. This will be a much better place if we share the knowledge and the other side is willing to take in.
How do you think most people in the United States would view the educational system and the whole world of China?
I cannot speak to anyone else, but last time I watched a YouTube video, I saw the comments. I read through the comments there. The comments were like, "There is pathetic. It's they are losing their childhood. They will be a robot after they get out of school."
Right.
I think everything is depends on how you take it and how you utilize it. So yes, it is pathetic in some way because we have to put in longer hours in the study in this single item of life. But on the other hand, the perseverance comes up and the foundation of science and the foundation of math knowledge comes up. So it highly depends on how we take it. So I would say, based on what I see from the YouTube comments, is more of a empathetic. Is that the right word to put it from the American society?
Not on very them? Empathetic. Yeah, and that's the point, is that once again, I think there is a lot of evidence to show that maybe things aren't quite that way. That it gets back to, we've got to somehow deal with the politics and the government situations, because the governments cause a whole lot more problems for all of us on all sides than anything else. And the way it really is, as opposed to the way the government says it is or wants it to be, are not the same at all.
And if we bring the whole U.S. education system into any developing country, it will totally not work. I'm not saying any education right. system is great, but it's just not going to work. If you bring this whole freestyle and also free choice education system to a rural place in a developing country, the student don't know what to choose. They need a foundation of education of how to survive in life because mm-hmm. their parents are gone. Their parents are in big city. They're living by themselves since very young. They're living with their grandparents and they're living on the minimum wage, such as a year they only earn several $50 a year. This is their whole income, the whole year. How can you just say you should think about your life in a better way rather than studying only? They don't have the privilege to think about that. This is also some minor factors. I would encourage people to look into the system before critiquing them.
Yeah. I had a conversation some time ago on this podcast with someone who came out of the era of communism in Eastern Europe and so on. And one of the things that they said was that the difficulty for most people when communism ended in their country was that they didn't know how to move forward. The communist regime made all your decisions for you. And in a sense, that's kind of what I hear you saying in some senses about education in China, but not necessarily in the same negative way. But what they said is that the communist regime made all decisions for you. And now the communist regime has gone and people have to learn to make decisions for themselves. And it's a whole new experience and they didn't know how to do it.
This is really true. In the culture, and both in the culture and both in the regime, because it has been there for hundreds of years, it's hard to overturn it overnight. If you are asking the students from their cultural background to ask questions in class right now, they're so uncomfortable doing it. and they feel they're doing something wrong for asking question or challenging the authority. Is nothing wrong or nothing right. It's just not fit in the system, cannot fit in the system right now. It might take several years, several decades to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I see the difference, and also why certain system cannot fit in. And you cannot always use the Western or American way to try to put into the other system, make
right.
it work.
Right. It isn't the same. I am sure that there are parts of the American system that would be of benefit in other environments, but I'm sure also that there are probably parts of other environments that would be invaluable in the American system.
Yeah, it's all our critical thinking process. There's no right or wrong answer. It's not black and white. It's a spectrum that all of us, when we gather more information, such as if I have the privilege of knowing the both of the system, I can compare them and see the difference. And you have the knowledge to compare them, and you can also tell the difference. And we exchange information, which can be a more unbiased and probably a more well put way, rather than you only look into one side of opinions rather than the other.
You could advise young students in any country or in any environment about education and so on. What would you advise them to do?
Curiosity. It's so important.
I knew you were going to say that, which is why I asked. Go ahead.
Yeah, we already touched base on that just several questions ago. I'm always thinking about that these days. Well, one thing I personally really enjoy is just one side note outside the question that we were talking about. What I enjoy is I reflecting on what I had so far, what I don't have, what I enjoy, what I don't enjoy. So curiosity has been so important for me that because of the curiosity, I want to learn other places, even though I have no correlation or connection with them. I want to know what is happening in your life. If you're from Bangladesh, what is the culture there?
Mm-hmm.
I've never been there. I want to learn from you. Because of curiosity, I got to talk to such as students from business school. What is your job? Why do you come? The curiosity leads to information, and information leads to a more well-rounded opinion because you have more unbiased and abundant information. Only abundant information can lead to unbiased opinion. This is just my take on education. So curiosity is so important. It's the key. And the second is self-reflection. Then what you enjoy, what you don't enjoy. The one thing I struggled a lot when I was a student in college was I did so bad in my statistics class. And I thought my life was going to end here. I'm losing my GPA and I'm losing my ranking in the major. But then I realized, why do I need to stay in the stat field if I'm not good at it? I can work on the aspects I'm good at. I am good at, so such as logical thinking, such as strategy. So if I'm able, I ever get a chance to talk about the skill sets and talk about education, I would say curiosity and self-reflection are two key points I have in mind.
And I think that goes beyond education. I think that it is something that we all should do. I think one of the greatest things that I've experienced in my life, especially since sometime in the 1990s, was the internet, because it gave me such access to information as a blind person that I didn't have access to before, because everything was in print. And print, although the technology had begun to be available to read print, through things like the original Kurzweil reading machine that evolved to better OmniFont character recognition over the years, it still was a relatively small way to get access to information, whereas the internet has just opened so many doors. And since I've always viewed life as an adventure anyway, it just seems to me the internet really helps to allow us to explore things. And we need to do it, and we need to keep an open mind. But in our country today, we're just seeing so many people who are locked into opinions, you know, like with the whole political situation, there's no discussing, there's no room for conversation, which is so scary.
Right. And technology, as you said, internet started booming in 1990s, and then all the way here, every single one of us almost in the world is on it. And there are new technologies coming up. One discussion I heard a lot, both in the media and also in the school, is technology good for education? Mm-hmm. I think it highly depends on how you use it still. There's no right or wrong answer. Is ChatGPT great for education? If you use it just for copy-pasting, you never learn. It's a bad education. But if you use it to help you understand the difficult concepts and you have a personalized interpretation of the answer it gives to you, it's such a great way to study. You don't need too much access to a instructor all the time. You still need an instructor to explain ideas to you, but you can do a lot of self-learning through that. Mm-hmm. So when I heard you talking about internet, I resonated a lot in the sense of internet. It's also connecting us. But if you don't use it right, it's wasting your time.
Sure. Sure. Well, and take ChatGPT and other large language models and so on that are now coming out in the whole, what we've been calling artificial intelligence. Not sure it's totally artificial, but the fact is that in reality, it creates challenges somewhat. But I do believe that technology is good for education. I think that ChatGPT, if used correctly, and I agree with you, but if used correctly, can be extremely helpful. I've used it to help write articles and blog posts. What I've done with it, though, I love to do this with ChatGPT. I'll ask it a question, or I'll tell it I want an article about one thing or another, and it provides an answer, and I say, I'm not sure I like that one. Give it to me again. And I've done like 8 or 9 different runs at something, and then I'll take them all, and I will take whatever and choose whatever elements from each one that I want to go in the article, and then add my own spin to it, because I know that it has to be my article. And you're right. They don't teach you. They give you things that you can use, but we still have to be the ones to put it together.
Right. And the way I interact with ChatGPT, that was also one way I interact. And the other way is sometimes my writing is really broken. It's not my native language. So
right.
There's certain words that I'm not sure what is the better one to the alternative choices. So I ask it, can you please rephrase it for me? And it helps a lot.
And there's nothing wrong with that.
Right.
It's still you doing it.
Right.
Right. It's still you doing it, and you still have to be the one to do it. Somebody was telling me, I think it was actually near Christmas time last year, about ChatGPT and how students were using it to just write papers and do exams and so on. And one of the things that I said is, what's going to happen with all of this, or in part what's going to happen, is that, yes, possibly you can develop ways for teachers to detect that something was written by ChatGPT as opposed to a student. But ultimately, isn't it really about seeing if people truly have gained the knowledge? And what's going to have to happen is that teachers are going to have to start asking more questions of students directly. Or even if they turn a paper in with ChatGPT that did the work, make the student defend the paper orally, without reading it, without looking at it, defend the paper. You can find out in so many ways whether a student has just cheated and not really done the work or not.
And we're, because of the technology in the education, the whole higher education system and or the college education is revolutionizing the way they define plagiarism and cheating, and define how to comprehend, how the students can comprehend, instead of just submitting the paper or submitting the assignment. There's whole bunch of the backend changes I'm excited about, and also I think is super helpful in the higher education system.
Yeah. And like with anything, we're only at the beginning.
Right. Just imagine that when the industrial revolution was two centuries ago, we already back then British thought it was the end of the labor and efficiency improvement, but that was just the beginning. Fast forward 200 years ago, here we are in Zoom.
One of my favorite examples about people's thoughts limiting their imagination is the story of a gentleman named Roger Bannister. Have you heard of him?
Not really.
So Roger Bannister always wanted to be the person who would run a mile in less than 4 minutes. And he was told by everyone, it couldn't be done. Physically, it couldn't be done. You would die if you went over or ran a mile in under 4 minutes. And everyone in the athletic world just said, this is not something that can be done. Then one day he did it in, I think, 1956, 56 or 57, 56, I think. Mm-hmm. He's from Britain. And he did it. And then what happened? Everyone started to be running the mile in less than 4 minutes. We talk ourselves into things. Of course, I love to tell people that you still haven't convinced me that the world isn't flat. You know, they say, well, you can look at it from space and you can see, well, that doesn't help me a bit. So how do I know that the world isn't flat? And there's an organization called the Flat Earth Society that has many arguments to prove that the world is still flat. Well, you know, fine. all I know is that gravity's keeping me here, and that's a good thing.
Flat earther. And there was a funny video. It was flat earther and scientist having a conversation of if Earth is flat. It was really funny.
Uh-huh.
So they were arguing with each other, and flat earthers felt scientists are stupid. And scientists were so offended by the stupid word putting on them. We publish hundreds of papers and you say we're stupid.
Well, publishing doesn't solve anything by itself.
Right.
So I don't know all I don't know all the arguments from the flat earthers as to why they say that the world is flat. I really should spend more time researching that just to see what they say, but whatever. I think generally we accept that the Earth is spherical. It isn't really round, it's spherical, but that's okay.
Yeah, it has its curve there.
Well, that's what they say. That's what some of you say anyway.
Oh, gosh. Challenged so much.
Yeah. Oh, it's fun. People come up with all sorts of arguments to do everything. So clearly you value education, and I would say that you would say it changes your life, and it's changed your life, right?
Definitely. Just my life, because of the education, because of the curiosity, and because of how I came to the other side and participating in education, it changed, and the direction has never been predictable up to now, which is exciting and which is also exhilarating.
So what do you want for you to be a great educator?
Good question. What I see I'm lacking right now, mm-hmm, is the empathy of, well, I'm biased because the way I learn, I try to use it to teach others. And I think this is the common problem for a lot of people. So the way I'm always reminding myself that try to learn how other people learn. And instead of just using my way to teach the students, teach my target audience. So the other one I have in mind is, I always believe the foundational education, so such as kindergarten and elementary school, the teacher there is actually doing a much harder job than college educator. Because in kindergarten, just imagine, how can you explain 1 + 1 = 2? It is not an easy job. So what I see a better education, a better educator, if I can be at some point, is I can explain the foundation of the knowledge in a more articulated way, rather than just take it as a default setting and take it as a for granted that people already know.
I find it interesting that you talk about the fact that what would make you a great educator is to deal with the things that you lack still, that you're only going to be a great educator when you learn more, which is an interesting and absolutely, it seems to me, very appropriate philosophy.
Right. The more I realize how much I don't know. That is the encouragement for me to keep in this field and learn as much as can. And I think it applies to most of the settings in life, that the more you know, you realize I only know a fraction of this world. I think you're muted.
I was thinking of what I wanted to say, but where do you think you'll be in 5 years? What do you see yourself doing, or how do you see yourself progressing? And of course, that also leads to more of a discussion about the whole issue of education and equity too, which I know we've talked a lot about in one way or another. So where do you see yourself in 5 years?
I still want to stay in the software product field, which I have been most comfortable with since I graduated from college. And I think I can devote a lot more in the such as education product ed tech. And I want to be a lecturer part-time. I still haven't figured that out, but this is something I want to do. So such as teach a class in college or teach a class in the local community. And also want to keep up with the volunteer in the prisoners community and see what I can still help, not only help, but also spread the word to others.
I gather from what you're saying, you see yourself continuing to do that here in the U.S.?
Yeah, it kind of depends on the opportunity. So such as how much I get paid, right? So how well the product fits in my personal interest.
Well, maybe you can take a rocket to Mars and start teaching people up there.
We can definitely do it.
Yeah. You have to learn Martian.
And I have to learn how to do math and how to teach and how to talk through them.
Oh, well, see, another adventure. But, you know, I think that all that you're saying is so great, because it still comes back to curiosity and it still comes back to learning. And it's something that we always all should be doing. We should find ways to learn and not just reject things out of hand just because we don't believe it.
This is the theme for today's podcast, is curiosity, is learn from others. Get rid of what you have so far.
Yeah, it's the only way to do it. Well, I want to thank you for being here with us. This has been fun. Can people reach out to you and interact with you in any way? How would they do that?
Sure. I'm pretty active on LinkedIn. If you're a LinkedIn user, you can search my name, you'll find me.
It's, why don't you spell that for me?
It's IRIS space YUNING space YE. I'm probably the only one you can find. So
yeah,
just use the search. The other way is my email is iye@umich.edu. So iye@umich.edu.
Yeah, better Michigan than Ohio State, you would say, right?
Go Michigan, go Wolverines. Mason Blood.
I have a friend.
Red color there.
I have a friend who just retired from the government a couple of years ago, but he got his advanced degrees in economics from the University of Michigan. We both were at UC Irvine at the same time, but then he went to University of Michigan. He loved to talk about the ongoing rivalry between Michigan and Ohio State during football season, which is always a series of fun stories to hear.
This is what I picked up from the American culture. You should be proud of your football team. Then if not, you're kicked out.
Yeah. Well, and I like college football a lot more than professional football, even though there's more and more money getting into college football. College football is still the sport that people can talk about, and you can have fun with it from all sides, and college kids still have a lot of fun with it.
Right. And we're still here staying strong. You mentioned staying strong.
That's it. Or as we say at USC, fight on. But you know, it's an important thing. Well, Iris Yungan Yi, I want to thank you for being here with us. This has been fun. We met on LinkedIn and I'm glad that we did. And you're going to have to come back in the future and tell us how things are going with you and talk about things you've learned and so on. So let's not let this be the only time you are on Unstoppable Mindset.
Cannot wait for it. And I'm so thankful for LinkedIn to connect us together and talk through this podcast and talk through what our value is and talk through the experience for both of us. So thank you so much, Michael.
Well, thank you. This has been fun. And now you get to go have dinner. And I want to thank you for listening to us out there. Would love to hear your thoughts. And I'm sure Iris would as well. So we'd love to hear from you. You can email me at Michael, M-I-C-H-A-E-L-H-I, at accessibe.com. You can also go to our podcast page, www.michaelhingson.com. And Hingson is H-I-N-G-S-O-N. So michaelhingson.com/podcast. Wherever you're listening, please give us a 5-star rating. We value it very highly. I hope people are enjoying all these conversations, these discussions. I know I am, and I'm learning a lot. And I can't complain about that one bit, because I think, as Iris has told us, it's all about being curious and it's all about desiring to learn and gain more knowledge. And so I think it's important to do that. Please give us a 5-star rating. Wherever you're listening to us, we value that. And once more, Iris, I want to thank you for being here. And this has been fun. And don't be a stranger.
Thank you, Michael.